have to realize that when we are trapped in an identification of the self with the physical body, we seem to have the illusion of free will and lose the reality of the free will. When we rise to the spiritual level of our soul and its totality, we become the very creator who wrote the script, and we get back our free will in full. Therefore, the feeling of free will comes natural to us, because the feeling of free will is coming from real free will of our own real status. Our own real status being total consciousness, which has free will, even when it is filtered down into so many masks of the mind, of the senses, of the physical body, and this operates as if it has its own choices to make. That consciousness carries its feeling of free will all the way, percolates right up to here. But why does it look that this has some limitations, that there must be God whom we have to look forward to? We are separating our real self from the self which we assume to be real in order to worship our real self by calling it God, calling him God, calling her God, whatever, depending upon how much the masculine power, what do you call, chauvinism is going on. They give it different sexes. The point is, when we rise in consciousness, which means when we become more aware of who we really are, we get knowledge, real knowledge of our own self. We discover that these forms that we are having are merely for local drama, for the stage upon which we have been placed. That the real script has already been written at the mental causal level. That the mental causal level is a creation of our own total self, which is God, the Creator. And all this can be discovered through a single journey in a single direction. The journey is the spiritual journey, the direction is within. It's as simple as that. If we can meditate upon our own self, self being the source of consciousness, if we can proceed in the direction of our own self, we keep on discovering why we are physically tied up in karma, in relationships, in patterns of life, in give and take, in pain and pleasure, in happiness and unhappiness. We can discover why this pattern was created, why it is necessary to have this pattern in order to have the physical experience. And we can rise to the astral or sensory experience and discover how that fits in with the physical experience and gets folded into the physical experience. We can rise to the causal and find out how the mental script, already written, creates and causes all these things to happen. We can rise above that and be our spiritual self and find the source of intuition, love, beauty, joy, all the good things that we ascribe to God. And we can rise further and find there is no individuation, there is no separation. We are deriving this experience which looks separate, like a dream. Like we go to sleep and have a dream and looks like hundreds of people have come there. Nobody has come. They've all come from the same source, from the same dreamer. Similarly, all this experience which looks like the experience of the many is coming from a single source of consciousness. This can come by waking up to that level of consciousness where we feel total in the totality of consciousness. We can rise still further and find that all the levels are in fact the same. And they are just manifestation of different forms of experience of consciousness. All these experiences we can have within ourselves and get the answers to all our questions. The Akashic records I referred to only reflect what is happening in the three worlds below. The world of matter, the world of energy, the world of thought. No more, but much more than that is happening in the world of love, in the world of spirit, in the world of real knowledge, in the world of real free will, which directs what script is to be written. And we have the access to go to that region. There have been many yogis, many people with great skills in using their energy centers, in using their energies at different levels in the body. And they impress us. But they are not using the spiritual power of love. They are using a lower power, which is even below our wakeful state. If you want to experience the six chakras, to see what tantric power, what psychic power means, you have to go below the eyes into the chakras. You have to descend, not transcend. You don't go up. You go into a state of what they call a kind of trance. It is no trance. It's sort of sleep. You have to induce a sleep state to experience the chakras, which because of their novelty,
look like you might have got something high. There's nothing high about it. When it is high, it's high in the sense of awareness. When you can see and be clear about what's going on, then you are high. Not when you are deluded and clouded and cannot see what is happening. That is not high. So, here is an opportunity. There have been yogis who have confined us to the psychic powers and call that healing. And there have been higher yogeshwars who have taken us above this and said, wake up to higher regions. And they taken us to the astral and causal regions and opened up our mind to the universality of this creation and our role in this universal creation. And there are still some others, some rare ones. We call them the perfect living masters. The perfect living masters have been very rare, but they've always been there for us because they represent our own truth, our own reality. They walk upon this earth and come and give us a simple lesson that we rise above even the mind and go into the world of love, because love comes from that part which does not exist in time and space. That is why the experience of love at that region, spiritual region, is without time and space. In the mental region, it is without time and space. In the sensory region, it is without time and space. In the physical region, it is without time and space. Love continues to have that special quality about it. They take us to the real spiritual regions, and we call them the perfect living masters. We call them Satgurus, the teachers of truth. And we have always recognized that there are very few of them. The others will come and say, come, follow us, we'll give you the truth. And those will hide in our midst. They will walk like ordinary people amongst us, and we will hurt them, we will abuse them, we might even crucify them and kill them, and they will still perform their role of teaching us by love. They heal us by love. Their method is love. Not only their spiritual mission is love, their spiritual method is love. Their healing is by love. Therefore, if there is real healing, which you can call spiritual healing, it has to come from love of that kind. Remember that a lot of people tell us all the time about different methods of healing. Those are transference of karma at best. It is not easy to transfer karma, but people do it. You wish strongly to transfer your karma to somebody else, you can do it. But some people are not even sincere about that. We have a story in India that a young daughter-in-law got sick. And she said, oh, I'm dying. And her mother-in-law was trying to, you know, give her crocodile sympathy, crying with crocodile tears. Oh, I'm so sorry. You are so sick. I wish I were sick. I am old. I could die. Why should you die? You are so young. You have a long life to go. At that time, a buffalo, we have some, like cows, we have milking buffaloes, domestic buffaloes there. One buffalo in the yard who was trying to feed itself in a little bucket of food got stuck. Its horns got stuck and the bucket got onto the face of the buffalo, and the buffalo ran, couldn't see, and ran and barged straight into the room where the mother-in-law was saying, oh, wish I could die, you couldn't. When she saw a bucket coming up, she thought this is the angels of death. She said, no, 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 I was joking, I wasn't serious. So many of us pay lip sympathy to this thing. But when we come to real healing, we want to really heal somebody, you have to heal with love and not with these notions of psychic powers and mental powers. I hope this introduction to our own inner variety, the treasures that lie inside, and the source of love as the power of healing, will interest you to look into your own self more and more. If some of you are coming to the workshop tomorrow, we'll do an actual introspection and try and go within and see what it is to see the mind and the senses and the body at work independently from the soul, which is the source of all love. Thank you. I shall be very glad to answer questions on the presentation I just given or on the presentation I have not given. Yes.
If you want it to be there like that, but it will come in the
The question is, how can you choose that kind of real love if it's not coming by itself? Because obviously, she understood correctly that real love cannot be planned and worked for. It just comes by itself. But we are so much used to using the mind for doing everything that we feel we have to make a choice even for that love. Is there a way to choose that love instead of choosing the egoistic attachment? Yes. One of the mystics said, if you cannot have real love, pretend to have it. You may get something. How do you pretend to have it? By doing exactly what would happen if you had real love, which means identifying with the other. Now, I have suggested this to my friends earlier. It has worked very well. So I would suggest the same thing. If you want to have love for a person, don't put yourself in a position of having to love that person. Forget about yourself. Think that you are that person. If you were in that person's place, how would you think? How would you feel? What would be your thoughts? What will you say? Put yourself in that person's place and love will start growing. You will also notice that if you don't speak at all, you go in the presence of a person and just to yourself give this suggestion. If I am that person, how would I feel? In the presence of that person, express to yourself inwardly the feelings of that person, the suffering of that person, the thoughts of that person, the questions of that person, and that person will feel better and healed before you have had a chance to say a word. So therefore, if we cannot have real love and devotion, let us start with the pretension of love and devotion. It works. I also heard once that smiling is a good thing. And if you don't feel like smiling, pretend you're smiling and sometimes you start smiling really. It works too. So any other question? Yes.
If you try to heal someone using love, are you doing something to that person's karma if you're successful?
No. Love is beyond karma. Let us understand what is karma. Karma is entirely a mental activity. Karma ends with the mind. It has never gone above into spiritual region. There is no karma in the spiritual regions. When we descend to the mental region and have to make choices with the mind, with thoughts, karma starts from there. Karma is not a physical activity or a physical relationship. Karma consists of the intentions and the mental thoughts we have for people. And they create the action and reaction. Therefore, when we are rising to love which is above thoughts, there is no karma. Healing with love takes no karma.
If the person is ill that you want to heal, was it their karma that made them ill? Is all illness caused through karma?
All illness can be attributed to karma, but you may not be involved in it. You can mitigate the karma and wipe it out. A person who has true love can destroy a lot of karma of oneself and others. That is one good advantage we have of the spiritual masters when they come into contact with us. They come into our lives and our lives undergo changes without anything. Our karma is wiped out in large chunks. So love destroys karma without affecting the person who is in love or expressing love. Yes.
I understood, but Master said that when you wipe out the karma, finished, then you die to the world.
Yes, if there is no karma left at all, then you die. Therefore, we need some karma to stay here. In fact, if we could stay here without karma, we would none of us have karma. But we need karma. There is a statement that karma is made first and then this body is made. Yeah. Unless you have a package, a full package of karma, we cannot stay in this physical experience, in this physical body.
Do we submit to karma and watch it function for us or with us or with our above divine law?
No, the karma has two kinds of expression. One is the manifestation of karma, say like sickness. Let's take the case of sickness. A person is ill or sick and a master comes and gives attention to that person with love and goes away. The person doesn't feel sick at all. Other people say that person is very sick. The person feels it's all gone. They say, no, you are still sick. It's only your mind saying so. So I don't know if it's mind or not, but I feel fine.
Yeah.
So the point is that karma, which has not only the power to create because of mental condition, it also suffers because of mental condition. When this karma is gone, the outline of it is retained to stay on here. That is why it is said that the masters do not interfere with the outline of the karma in order to enable you to take advantage of being here. And I'll just tell you what it means to enable you to take advantage of being here. They reduce the pain of the karma, they reduce the intensity of suffering of that karma and leave an outline so other people don't know what benefits you got, but you know it fully, what benefits you get. Now, what is the advantage of having karma and coming into this world? The advantage is that this physical body, with its illusion of free will, this feeling I can do, this is the starting point of seeking the higher truth. There is no other way we can start towards the higher truth. Today, I have come here and I have spoken and shared with you how lucky we are to have a human body in which we can find all these secrets inside. Supposing we didn't have human bodies. Supposing we had other bodies. Supposing we were trees. In the forest we go and all the trees are there. They don't share this with themselves. They are bound by karma. They can't think. They can't decide. They have no free will. They can't even seek. Therefore, they are disqualified. The birds chirp and they enjoy according to nature. They can't seek. The angels know everything, including the script. They can't seek. The gods have known everything. They've written the script. They can't seek. We are the only lucky ones left, the human beings. The human being is the top of creation because it is a strange combination where in spite of the delusion of this physical universe, we still retain the consciousness of the chooser, of the choice maker, which is the totality. And therefore, even in the illusion of free will, even we feel we have free will, having no free will, in this illusion, we can seek and find out what the true free will was. So therefore, karma is necessary for us to be here. It is necessary for us to be here in order to seek getting out of here. There's no way out. If you study spiritual philosophy and literature, you will find that the human body is needed. The human life is needed in order to escape from the miseries of the human life. In order to escape from the miseries of every life, including higher life of angels and demons. You need the human body and the human feeling before you can escape. This is like a gateway. Because in this form alone, out of all forms created, there are only two forms in which free will exists. In the form of the creator, who has real free will, and in the form of the human being, who feels he has the free will. None else has got any of this feeling. Therefore, this is created in the image of the creator. A human being, in the conscious sense, is the only creation which is created in the image of the creator. Just like that. Therefore, karma which sustains this is welcomed. We welcome karma, a package of karma. And why should karma be nasty and painful? It should all be good. No, if it is all good karma, supposing we did all good deeds, supposing in this life we did all good deeds, we're all good, fine people, we'd go to heaven and stay in heaven, being able to do nothing. We can't even seek God in heaven. I hope you knew that. You had to come back to earth to seek God. Well, supposing we did all bad things, we'd go to hell and then seek no God. It is only when we have a combination of ups and downs, we have a combination of karma, that we get this human form. And the human form is the top of creation from where we can get out. Therefore, karma performs a very positive function in keeping us here. But since it becomes too terrible sometimes and it weighs down upon us, therefore, the creator who gave us these forms, he comes forth himself in the form of these masters, in the form of the enlightened ones, in the form of the Son of God. And he comes and tells us the way out while we are in the human body. And he, by his presence, keeps the outline of the karma so we can remain a seeker and removes the intensity. So that if a person has to be hanged with a noose around his neck, it becomes like a little pinprick around his wrist. That is the nature of the change that takes place from the love that we get from these masters. Yes?
Can you explain what you think Jesus meant when he said to love your neighbor as yourself?
Love your neighbor as yourself? Yes, he said don't be a hypocrite. Be sincere. Because that's what I was saying earlier about the woman who was frightened by the bucket. She was loving the daughter-in-law, but she wasn't loving like herself. So when she thought death was upon her, she changed. So therefore, what Jesus meant was that when you love, love as you would yourself. But in that, he was not referring to a spiritual activity of the higher self, but wanting that love should be sincere. Because he saw in those days, as we see in these days, that love has become a lot of hypocrisy. Do you know the most frequently used words? I love you. Is that true? And how many times is it sincerely meant? I put it to you. I don't know, you have heard it. How many of you have heard this phrase? I love you. Everybody, so many times. And how many times have you found that that wasn't love? Has anybody found that? Then, it's such a commonplace now. If you love somebody, love somebody. Love as you would love yourself. Put yourself in the place of the neighbor. That is what I was talking. If you want to experience love, the easiest way is to put yourself in place of the neighbor. Then you would love your neighbor as thyself. If you don't put yourself in place of the neighbor, you don't love. You're just trying to be patronizing. You're not sincere. So Jesus was recommending the path of love. As you know, Jesus' main path was path of love. He put love the highest. All masters have done that. They have put love as the highest method. Therefore, love should be real. Love should come from the spirit. Love should not be cultured from the thoughts. One should not say, now I want to love this person. Now let me plan, how do I do it? Flowers or roses or what? Not like that. If you want to love, forget everything else and put yourself in place of that person. Love that person like you would love yourself. Think that is you there, and love will come into you. Yes.
So we understand the benefit of karma relative to the human conscious form. Does that relationship continue as the spirit goes through immortality or progresses in immortality? Is there still a karmic relationship?
No. The karmic relationship ends when we ascend above the mental regions into the spiritual region. The spirit is not bound by karma at all.
So there is no sort of similar relationship going on out of pride?
No.
That's good to know.
Very heartening. Yes.
Are there any masters walking the earth now?
Yes. My belief is that there is always at least one perfect master walking upon this earth. And there may be more. There could be more. The belief is based upon this, that the Creator has been equal to all of us and has not given any special partial treatment to any particular period of history. And if He has appeared in one form, He has said He will appear again and has appeared again and again and again and will continue to appear again and again. Always masters walking upon this earth. A logical question would be, how do we find such a master? The answer is, you can't. The master can find you, if it's a perfect master. If it's a perfect master, he's walking upon the earth not for his own good, but in response to our seeking. If we seek, we find him. How do we find him? Because we seek. Therefore, what is our role in finding out where a perfect master is walking? Our role is to seek within. And the perfect master comes in front of us, comes in our way. Through what process does he come? Through a simple process which the masters have used all the time, which is called coincidence. Anybody heard the word coincidence? Most of the miraculous things, real spiritual things happen through coincidences. And this is a beautiful experience. I have seen it repeated all over the world, how people who did nothing but seek in their own hearts went through a series of coincidences and landed up finding the guide, the spiritual teacher, the friend, the master, who was the representation of that love which they were seeking. Yes?
I'd like to know, is it possible for a person to love someone and then not even subconsciously become ill?
A person may love someone and that not be mentally conscious of it, because mental consciousness is different. Sometimes we have love for a person, and the feeling of identification, the feeling of being one, close to that person, being one with that person comes. But our thoughts are taking somewhere else and we become unconscious. The mind is such a strange thing that very often these experiences which are spiritual, when they come to us, we put them aside and become unconscious of them. It is not only true of love, it is also true of intuition. Have you ever seen, you get a hunch that you know something? And the mind starts saying, oh, no, that's not possible. And you go on the logical path. And after years, you say, I know I had a hunch about it. I wish I had listened to my hunch. We put it aside. The same thing happens with love. You may love someone and the mind doesn't accept it, so you're unconscious of it. The mind pushes it away. The mind wants to take over that space as quickly as it can. So you may have an experience of love and the mind tries to fill that space of that love experience with thought experience. thoughts, commentary, comment upon it. No, can't be. Most of the comments create doubt. Why is the mind negative? Sometimes they say the mind is negative. The mind plays a negative role because it creates two negative features. They are called doubt and fear. Have you had that experience? That even in a good case of love, even in a real case of love, where you feel so happy at a certain development spiritually, when you get so intoxicated and so identified with someone that you feel love, the mind steps in like a voice says, can you be sure? Is this real? Not only create doubt, from doubt creates fear. Do you notice every time there is doubt, there is fear? Fear comes from the unknown. Doubt makes you feel there is something not known to you. Therefore, the mind is performing this function all the time. Same is true of intuition. Intuition is always reliable. I have been claiming it for so long, all my life. Since childhood, I have been claiming that intuition can always be relied upon. People try and look at me and say, you are taking a big risk with yourself and with others. I say, I haven't taken a risk. When I fail, I will tell you. I'll come out openly and say, intuition failed with me. I haven't had a chance to do that. How can I say? And I have been placed in all kinds of circumstances of life. And therefore, intuition has worked where reason has failed. But then every time intuition comes to us, gives us a clear answer. Fact comes from somewhere, a clear answer. And from the other side sneaks the mind. The thought says, how can you be sure about it? You know, you can't rely on these things. It's not logical. It doesn't make sense. And there we go. Doubt is created. And that doubt creates the problem, not the intuition. Go back into your own lives and see. Look into your life from tomorrow. Test it out from tomorrow. Let the intuition flow. And remember the difference between intuition and that mental thought. Mental thought takes time, intuition takes no time. Mental thought comes from some cause and has a cause-effect relationship. Intuition comes from no cause and has no cause-effect relationship. Remember the distinction and see how it works. The Lord gave us two wonderful things. A beautiful soul, the motive force, consciousness, which makes us aware, made us alive, gave us a world of manifestation, gave us the joy of this creation, and gave us a mind to work for us, to say, do this, do that. But we started putting the cart before the horse. Instead of telling the mind to do this, we began to tell the mind, what do you want us to do? And made a mess of it. Tell the mind to do things. Rely upon intuition and use the mind to carry out, implement what the intuition is saying. You'd have a first-class life on top of the world. But if you say, no, I want to think out what I want to do, and then I thought out yesterday I want to do this, but today I found I made a mistake because I didn't know certain things. Have you ever felt that? When the mind wants to take decisions, it has to decide on certain given information, on certain basic premise. When it is taking a decision, it says because of this, it should be like this. It takes into account a certain bit of information and takes a decision. And next day, next week, next month, next year, new information comes. Say, oh, I didn't know about that, so I made a mistake. Extra information makes the previous decision wrong. This is how the mind works. Intuition does not function like this. Intuition does not function on the information you feed to it. Intuition functions on the totality of information that your consciousness holds and comes from there as the right course of action at that time. So follow it, then make the mind do that. You don't go wrong. I'm making bold to say this from personal experience. I'm sharing with you. You can share with me if some other system works better. It's as plain as that. Therefore, you try it out. But even this statement I'm making is subjected to scrutiny by the mind and says, well, should we try or not? So you see, the mind creates doubt. Doubt creates fear. Yes?
If you have an illness or a disease, can you cure yourself?
Yes, certainly. If you can cure others, you can cure yourself. In fact, the first lesson is heal thyself. They have said, physician, heal thyself. Healer, heal thyself. First heal yourself, then heal others. Supposing my house is on fire, it's no use my running around to put out the fire of other houses. I should first put out the fire of my own house. There are people walking about, they say we are counseling people how to be peaceful and calm, and they're full of anger and temper themselves. So one must heal oneself first. Charity begins at home. Start all this from yourself. First, let the input go within. When you are at peace with yourself, when you are aware of yourself, you'll be a very strong factor in healing others. But if you are not healed yourself and are not aware of the source of love within you, your effect on others will not be very strong. There was a Swami, a master in India. He was well known for his profound influence on children. Whatever he said, children listened. It was a great boon for the mothers, because children would never listen to the mothers. So they found an easy way. They would take the child to that Swami, say, Swami, this child doesn't listen to me, doesn't go to school. And Swami would say, child, go to school. And child would start going to school from next day. So they found a very handy use of the Swami. So one day, there was a mother whose child was taking too much candy. And he was getting sores and he was getting unhealthy. And he wouldn't stop. He would steal money. He would steal candy. He would buy somehow and eat too much candy. So the mother said, let me take this child to the Swami. So she took the child to the Swami and said, Swami, this child takes too much candy. Please tell him to stop. The Swami looked at the child and said, bring him next week. So the mother went home. After 1 week, took the child again and said, Swami, I'll come back again. This child is still eating too much candy. And the Swami said, child, don't take candy. And next day, the child stopped taking candy. Intrigued by the fact that why was she given 1 week's adjournment, she went back to the Swami. She said, if all you had to do was to tell the child not to take candy, why didn't you say it last week? And the Swami said, ma'am, the truth is, I was taking candy myself at that time. I had to stop taking candy before my words could be effective. Therefore, physician, heal thyself. Yes.
I've worked on a lot of different techniques to get out of the body, hard on different things, including some of the ones you use too, like with pineal. And I found that when I just was quiet and easy, I didn't really work on anything, and I wasn't making an effort, that's when I got some success and went out. So what kind of energy is that?
Good question. I don't know how many of you do meditation, but how many of you do meditation? That means sit with eyes closed and withdraw consciousness within. Anybody does that? Please raise your hands. Okay, thank you. So you'll understand. I have seen from experience, when we try very hard, it doesn't work. When we give up, almost fed up, and give up, at that time it works. Has anybody seen that? Now why is that? The reason is simple. There is no obstacle to our vacating the body, getting into a higher region, getting into a different level, dimension of experience, just by withdrawing to ourselves. But when we try to withdraw, we put the ego in front. Trying is ego. When we put the ego in front, we put another brick on the very wall we are trying to break. There is no other wall. Let me tell you, between truth, reality and ourselves, there is no wall except our own ego. If that is the situation, the more effort we make, the more bricks we are putting on the same wall. The harder we try, the more difficult it becomes. And it is natural it should become difficult. But then the question is, we know no other method except to try. What should we do? Therefore, these clever masters, they come and teach us in a very systematic way. They say, try hard. That's the starting lesson. Try hard. Do more meditation. Do this mantra, do this sadhana, do this. They make us try so hard. We say, master, doesn't work. We are fed up. He says, you are? Now see what happens. It works. Now the question is, if that is the way, why should they first tell us to try hard? Why don't they say relax? Because when we relax, we still try hard to relax. Another friend of mine from Harvard wrote a letter to me. And he said that, I found that all the effort I am making, the struggle I put in, is itself becoming an obstacle to successful meditation. And that hasn't worked. So now I am going to try hard the effortless method. That is why the spiritual path has to be in a certain order because of our minds. It has to go in such a way that if we have to try hard, we have to try hard. Why? Not because trying hard will get us anywhere. It will get our mind into a corner against the wall. It will go no more. The harder we try, it's pushed against the wall. That's the time to relax. Automatically we give up effort and effort doesn't work. Supposing we said in the beginning, I don't want to put an effort. The spiritual path is effortless. And the mind says, that's a good method. Let me try that. Effortless. Never works. Therefore, you have to put an effort and give up when it doesn't work. The mind gets satisfied that particular effort did not work. If the mind is not satisfied, it still keeps on in the shelf, a scheme. Okay, after you try this, I'll bring up the next one. That's why it doesn't work. Effortlessness is the answer. But effortlessness cannot be achieved unless you put an effort. Yes.
Talking about eliminating the ego, a good approach is to integrate it rather than eliminate it.
Yes, actually, ego is never eliminated. Its truth is realized, which is integration. But it looks like when we explain this, just like effort and effortlessness, when we explain, we say, remove the ego, eliminate it. If you eliminate the ego, you would eliminate the seeker. Therefore, it's not truly that. But the true statement is that when you eliminate the ego, you only eliminate the face of your personality, which looks like the ego, and integrates with the rest. Well, I'm very happy to spend time with you, and I hope you enjoyed the thoughts I shared with you as much as I enjoyed them. And some of you will be here tomorrow for the workshop. How many of you are going to be here? Oh, quite a few. So we'll meet tomorrow and try some practical lessons on what we've been talking about. Because I have always said that no amount of talk, no amount of listening can give us results unless we practice them. Please remember that. In the spiritual path, it is of utmost importance that whatever we read, whatever we listen to, whatever we preach or speak, we must practice. It's the practice that will give us the results and the confidence and the faith. Nothing else will give. The faith that is just sustained by the mind accepting certain statements is not good enough. The faith that comes from experience, from actually practicing, is the faith that sustains us all the time. So tomorrow, those of you who are joining the workshop, we'll try to practice what we have preached today. Thank you very much and good night.